Well, it's old home week. We have a reunion of sorts going on the Central Texas Gardener set. We're joined by Skip Richter, who is an alumnus of the Central Texas Gardener. And great to have you be a part of the program again. You are currently the AgriLife Extension Horticulturalist in Houston.
Yes.
Welcome back.
Thank you. It's good to be back.
We have a great topic to discuss today, and that is beneficial insects, mm-hmm. how to know them and how to encourage their presence in your garden. Yeah. And this is a topic that you're really passionate about, and it mm-hmm. grows from your experience of just taking some time to look.
That's right. The more I get close up to nature and look and learn, the more fascinated I become.
Right.
And rather than seeing it's me versus the pests in the garden and mm-hmm. I've got to kill everything, whether it's synthetic or organic sprays, that approach, getting and looking at how nature operates. What I did one day as I was out in the garden, and I just sat down and started looking at one of my coal crop leaves. I turned it over, and there were a bunch of aphids on it. Mm-hmm. And then this little gnat-like thing crawling around. And it was going up to the aphids. And so I used my phone, which by a little hand loop, which is about 10 bucks, and sticking it over the lens of your phone, now your whole phone screen becomes this giant magnifier. And I saw that it was a parasitoid wasp going up and laying eggs in aphids, individual aphids. Mm-hmm. And that just got me started. And I just think if people would take time to go out and sit in the garden a minute and watch up close.
Right.
And even when you see a pest, don't just run to go kill it. Look at what's going on around it. And you may find that your job's been done.
Right. And the beneficial insects, you don't want to kill them. In fact, you encourage putting plants in the garden to attract them.
I actually do. That's a hard sell for gardeners.
Yeah.
But one of my favorite plants for that is the tropical milkweed, or also called Mexican mm-hmm. milkweed, mm-hmm. with the yellow and orange flowers on top. It just loads up with a yellow aphid we call the oleander aphid. Mm-hmm. And I plant those in the garden because it covers up with aphids. But that aphid doesn't get on my roses or tomatoes or crepe myrtles mm-hmm. or coal crops or anything. It is specific to that plant. And one day I turned a leaf over and saw about 12 parasitized aphids and a lady beetle larva and two surfeit fly larvae, mm-hmm. all on one leaf. And I realized this isn't an aphid problem. This is a nursery for beneficial insects.
Right.
So when that lady beetle goes through its life cycle and goes flying around, it has to go 4 feet to get mm-hmm. to my plants rather than come across the St. Augustine yards of the neighborhood, and I hope it discovers my little garden there.
Right, right. So effectively, you're putting food crop out for the beneficial insects, knowing that they're going to take care of more than what you're serving.
Absolutely. You know, some adults and their young eat aphids, like lady mm-hmm. beetles and their mm-hmm. larvae, and some adults feed on pollen of flowers and nectar, and their babies eat the aphids, or whatever the pest is we're talking about.
This is really exciting work, and I think that a lot of people are keen to hear this kind of thing. They want to do right by Mother mm-hmm. Nature. But how do they learn, where do they go to learn what is beneficial and what is harmful?
There is a lot of good websites out there. There's one called bugwood.org, bugwood, strange word, mm-hmm. .org, that is insect images from across the country that entomologists, people send them in, they go put the name on them and categorize them. So you could go hunting for a particular insect by its proper scientific name mm-hmm. or by its common name. You can just learn more and more.
Yeah.
But you become the expert on what's in your garden here.
Of course. Yeah. And that, but to become an expert, people need to replicate kind of what you did, mm-hmm. which is to stop for a moment and just pay attention, which is a very rare thing nowadays.
You just learn what's going on. I use those plastic containers that salad comes in, the mm-hmm. little boxes. And I have a little vases, and I'll pick a leaf that's got an unknown larva on it mm-hmm. or a pupa, put it in there and close the door and set it in the house and just watch it and see what comes out of it.
Interesting.
And that's how I learned a lot of the different insects that mm-hmm. we have.
That's smart.
It's just, now most people wouldn't put up with having bugs inside the house, but going out to the garden and just sitting and being still, because some of the best beneficials are the ones you don't see.
Yeah.
When you're just looking at the garden from a distance.
You can learn so much, and people need to get over the fear of insects. One thing that I've heard is that, I mean, plants actually recruit insects by sending out pheromones into the air, and they say, come help me, I've got a pest here, I need a little hand.
It is amazing. This is a new frontier in entomology and plant insect relations. Mm-hmm. Yeah, when a pest chews on a plant may put out some type of a pheromone that other plants pick up, and they start to make defenses against the insect because their neighbor told them there's a problem over here.
Right.
Beneficial insects pick up that pheromone, certain ones, and that may tell them, I'm likely to find a meal down on this plant, and they kind of hone in.
Right.
And then there's all kinds of other ways that interaction goes on.
It's amazing. Above the ground and under the ground as well, all sorts of interactions.
Yeah, interaction between roots and it's just fascinating.
Right. Well, you have some really practical things that you've done in your garden to create kind of like delis for the beneficial insects. Let's talk a little bit about that, because I love the strategies you devised.
Well, if you build it, they will come.
Right.
It's true. And one thing, as I mentioned earlier, some of the adult beneficials need pollen and nectar. In fact, even lady beetles will go and feed a little bit on that. But so you need some flowers that are in the daisy family, like chamomile or daisies or coneflower and other things. They're real easy for the insects to get into the nectar. Mm-hmm. Flowers that are in the carrot family, they have an umbrella-like seed head, and that would be things like yarrow, for example. Mm-hmm. Or when I harvest my carrots, I leave a few at the end of the row to go ahead and bolt, and they send up a lot of these wonderful flowers that just really attract things in. And I've got all the rest of that bed to plant the next crop in.
Sure.
And there's a lot of other ways to go about that. But there's herbs are great, chives, and when they bloom, bring in a lot of pollinators and other
things. And it's interesting you say that, because as you talked about letting plants bolt and go to seed, I just recalled, I can remember so many times being out in the garden and seeing a plant that had bolted and it would be covered with insects.
Yes. And I've evolved a lot over the years from that traditional farm-looking garden where everything was controlled and we pounded the soil to death with rototillers and to more of a trying to make more of a natural setting without just making it a wild garden, which is fine. Mm-hmm. Cottage gardens are fine. But I want to get the most production that I can out of it, and yet at the same time, bring in all of the things that are helping me so I don't have to get out there and spray.
Well, it makes sense. It's cheaper, it's better for Mother Nature, it's easier for you in the long run, right?
And it's fun.
Exactly.
It is just fascinating.
It is, fascinating and wondrous.
Right. If I just want vegetables, I can go to the store and buy a carrot. Mm-hmm. But where can I sit and look and learn and see this interaction going on?
Well, you have some other strategies, including what you call insectary buckets.
Yes.
Stop for a moment. Tell us what an insectary is, and then describe the bucket idea.
An insectary garden is a garden designed to bring in beneficials, and it could be just an ornamental, like a cottage garden of sorts. Or you could do it in your vegetables. My particular vegetable plot is a little small, so I don't want to give up space planting all of these flowers everywhere. I have a few. So I use buckets to grow plants that I know will attract beneficials. Alyssum in the cool season, and lobularia in the warm season, and small daisy-like flowers like I mentioned. Mm-hmm. And I have a post in the garden, and I just hang a couple of buckets on it. In fact, I have buckets all the way around the periphery of the garden. And so when a particular annual starts not blooming, or it kind of finishes its season, I can just bring a bucket with something blooming in. So without giving up garden space, I've got all of these insectary plants that are present.
Well, that's, I think, a very wise approach, and especially for people nowadays with such tight garden spaces.
Yes.
We can't grow acreage, right?
Yes.
Nobody can do that anymore, but we can have these little pocket gardens that include the kinds of elements that you're just talking about, which is really great. You know, one thing that you alluded to earlier, and I just want to underscore too, is, our tendency to always want gardens to be hyper tidy,
Yes.
And having some freedom there to let things get a little loose, and sometimes bolting and things like that can really be of great benefit to the overall project, right?
It really can, yes. And being willing to just experiment with different things, find out what works for you and how you want it to look.
Mm-hmm.
Some people are very engineer-oriented. It's all square, right angles, you know, perfect boxes with string. And other people are just like, the garden just looks wild.
Yeah,
and that's
right.
Fine, too.
Sure,
It's your garden. Do what you want with it.
Exactly.
And the fun thing about gardening is it's like a big Etch-a-Sketch. You can draw whatever you want. If you don't like it, you just shake it, and you get to start over. And that shaking is called pulling all the plants up and replanting. You know?
Well, shaking to the benefit of all the great insect friends that we have out there. Skip
yes.
Richter, this has been a lot of fun. Great to see you again. Best wishes to you and to the good work you're doing in Houston. We miss you here in Austin, though.
Well, thank you very much. I've enjoyed it.
All right. Coming up next, it's Stephanie.